So let's backtrack a bit and make sure everyone understands how the greenhouse effect works and how anthropogenic greenhouse gas emissions can cause a rise in global temperatures. First, remember the layers of the atmosphere. Climate change is a tropospheric phenomenon. The temperatures of our oceans and our near-Earth atmosphere are rising. Next, some basic physics. Solar radiation from the sun comes to us in the form of electromagnetic waves. There are many different types of electromagnetic radiation, and the types are classified by their wavelength. Ultraviolet waves have a shorter wavelength than visible light, and infrared have a longer wavelength than visible light. Here's the complete electromagnetic spectrum. Note where ultraviolet radiation exists, visible light, and infrared. These are the shorter wavelengths, and then they get longer as you go this direction. Solar radiation that reaches the Earth is composed primarily of visible light, infrared radiation, and a little bit of ultraviolet light as well. Note the difference between solar radiation, which is mostly shortwave radiation, ultraviolet, visible light, and a little bit of infrared, and compare that to the radiation given off by the Earth, which is entirely in the longer infrared region. Notably, infrared radiation is basically heat. Thus, from now on, we're going to talk about solar radiation as shortwave radiation. This is the radiation from the sun. And when we talk about longwave radiation, we're talking about the radiation from the Earth. So the sun and the Earth emit different types of radiation. The sun emits shortwave, and the Earth emits longwave. Got it? So what can happen to all that radiation? Well, there are four things that can happen to any type of radiation. It can be reflected. When this occurs, the wavelength doesn't change. So when sunlight, shortwave radiation, like visible light, hits a mirror or snow or ice, it's simply reflected back as shortwave radiation. This is why you can get a nasty sunburn when swimming or skiing. You're getting the shortwave radiation from the sun, and then you're getting it again as it's reflected back off the ice or snow or water. Radiation can also be scattered. When the light hits particulates in the atmosphere, it can get scattered in all directions. But again, the wavelength doesn't change. Radiation can also be transmitted. For example, visible light is easily transmitted through a window. Though thankfully, most ultraviolet light is not transmitted, so you don't get a sunburn inside the house. Similarly, infrared is not generally transmitted through windows either. So different materials and different substances have different abilities to transmit radiation. Lastly, radiation can be absorbed. When an object absorbs solar radiation, it then re-emits that radiation as well, but the wavelength changes. The Earth absorbs the shortwave radiation from the sun, and then it re-emits it as longwave radiation, infrared, heat. Okay, so let's put this all together. The atmosphere transmits the shortwave radiation from the sun, mostly visible light, some infrared and some UV. The Earth absorbs that solar radiation and then re-radiates back longwave radiation back into the atmosphere. Greenhouse gases within the atmosphere absorb longwave radiation. They don't allow it to be transmitted through. They absorb that radiation and then re-radiate it, and some of that re-radiated radiation comes back towards the Earth. It prevents it from escaping the troposphere, and thus the troposphere warms. Consider pausing the video and going through those steps again. This is very important. Next, I want to dispel two common errors. First, greenhouse gases are not trapping solar radiation from the sun. Remember, the shortwave radiation is transmitted through the atmosphere. Second, greenhouse gases are not trapping radiation that's simply reflected off the ice and water of the Earth. That reflected radiation is still shortwave radiation, and it's transmitted right through the atmosphere. It's only the long-wave radiation emitted from the Earth that is trapped by the greenhouse gases. Importantly, the greenhouse effect is not a bad thing, and it's a natural process. Actually, this blanket of greenhouse gases is what keeps the planet livable. Without the greenhouse effect, the Earth would be a frozen, lifeless planet. The problem is that we humans have upset the balance by releasing too many greenhouse gases into the atmosphere, primarily through fossil fuel burning. Here's infographic 12.3 from your text, showing, on the right-hand side, the enhanced greenhouse effect. Humans have enhanced the natural greenhouse effect by putting extra carbon dioxide, extra methane, extra nitrous oxide, and extra halocarbons into the atmosphere. Much of this has been done by the burning of fossil fuels, though there are other sources of these gases as well. Here's a list of some of the important greenhouse gases that exist in our troposphere. Notably, water vapor is a greenhouse gas, but humans are not generally having as great an impact on the amount of water vapor in the air as we are on some of these other greenhouse gases, though there are some interesting exceptions. Anyway, the most important anthropogenic greenhouse gases are carbon dioxide, methane, halocarbons, and nitrous oxide. And of those, CO2 is by far the most important. You should be able to list these gases and also note several sources of each of these gases. This famous graph is called the Keeling curve, named for the scientists who first started taking CO2 measurements at the Mauna Loa Observatory in the 1950s, Charles David Keeling. You can see here that despite our understanding since 1977 that CO2 is a driver for climate change, carbon dioxide levels have continued to increase, at an increasing rate even. Students often ask why the curve has a small up and down movement to it each year. Well, the low part is during the Northern Hemisphere's summers. Most of the Earth's land masses and forests are in the Northern Hemisphere. So in the summer, when these forests are actively photosynthesizing, global CO2 levels decline slightly. It's not just CO2 that's been increasing, though. Check out this data from the Fifth Assessment Report. All of the greenhouse gases have increased. And here's the data from the 1970s. Again, carbon dioxide has increased the most. And as you can see from the graph on the right, CO2 is the gas that is most important in terms of global warming potential, in large part because there's so much of it in the atmosphere. So what's responsible for all that extra CO2 in the atmosphere? Well, as we've been saying all along, fossil fuel combustion. What does that mean? Well, electricity generation, driving of your car, industrial practices, etc. You should be able to name several sources for CO2 and also for the other greenhouse gases.